flesh tries to hide and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. You're the name above all names. You're worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing, how great is our God. You're the name above all names.
What shall I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits toward me? So I must ask today, what will you render? What will you render? Come on and give him your worship on today. I want everybody to join in right here. Lift those hands. Last time.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great our God. All will see how great is our God.
Good evening. Welcome to another Wednesday in the Word. I pray that you and your family are well, that you are blessed, that you are experiencing all of the love, the joy, the grace, the peace, the healing. I pray that you are experiencing every blessing that God has in store for you. Listen, God is great, and he is greatly to be praised. I am so excited that we can come into your homes, into your offices, to wherever you may be, to declare the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am so excited to kind of pick up where we left off a little bit from last week. And actually, as we have been in this series, in Wednesday in the Word, tying it into wisdom in the Word. And I pray that as you encounter, as you dig deep into the Word of God, that you have found yourself becoming much more wise. Marvin Sapp says, I become wiser, I become better. Oh, so much better. You and I have become stronger in God because of the wisdom of God's Word. And listen, because we are applying the Word of God to our lives. Amen. Listen, I want to jump in tonight and dig into what I believe God would have us to look into. So get your Bibles, get your smart devices, get your notepads, and let's breathe a word of prayer and ask God's blessings on our time. And then we're going to dig right in Proverbs chapter number 10. Will you bow with me? God, our Father, how we thank you and praise you for this day. We Thank you, dear Lord, because we know that it is in you that we live, we move, and we have our very being. We thank you for this time, dear Lord, that we could gather around the virtual table to discuss and to declare the truth of the gospel. Father, I thank you for these, your sons and daughters. I thank you for your healing virtue. I thank you for God's strength and comfort. I thank you, dear Lord, for being everything, God, that we need you to be. You have been that and so much more. And for this, we thank you and praise you. Now, Lord, as we acknowledge you and your greatness, we acknowledge our own sins and faults and failures and pray and ask that you will please forgive us for every single sin and thought and word and in deed. Now, dear Lord, I pray for my brother and sister. I pray that you will meet them at their point of need, God. Encourage them, strengthen them, bless them, heal them, deliver them, set them free by your power. Now, dear Lord, tonight, I pray that you will speak to us and speak through us in your word. Open up our hearts and our minds, God, that we can receive the engrafted word, which is able to save our souls. So I thank you by faith for what is to come. God, and we do this in the name that is above every name, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank God, and amen, and amen. All right. So, for those who were here or weren't here on last week, we talked a little bit about the things that God hates. Yeah, things that God hates. We took that last week from Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 through 19. Proverbs 6, 16 through 19, and it says these things Solomon identified. It says, these six things the Lord hates. Yes, seven are an abomination to him. A proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil, a false witness who speaks lies, and one who sows discord among the brethren. Can you say amen to the word of God? Listen, we understand that God hates sin. Don't categorize it. Don't try to put this sin above that sin. You know how we do. Don't do that. God hates all sin, but God loves all sinners. God loved all of us so much that he sent Jesus to be the propitiation. He is the answer. He is the cure. He is the remedy for our sins. Amen. But here's one of the things that is important. If you and I want to please God and we want to make God happy, we want to make God smile, then it is mandatory for us to try not to do the things that displease him. Amen. Solomon identified these seven things, these seven things that God hates. And I believe as you and I are sons and daughters of God, and as we want to grow in the grace and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and we want to please God, we want God's hand to be on us, we want God's favor, we want God's blessings, then it is up to us to make sure that we don't do the things that displease him. Amen. So if you're doing some of these things, just stop it. Mama used to say that you get in trouble and you're doing something. She'd just say, just stop. You have the ability to stop. How is that? Because if you're a son, a daughter of God, you remember the scripture says, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. So the Holy Spirit living within you is greater than any sin, any opposition that you're going to face. So you, child of God, can make a difference and stop if you're doing these things. All right, good. So here we are. We're moving on. Tonight, I want to jump to chapter number 10. Chapter number 10. Now, you're going to have some homework, so don't put your Bibles away too quickly. Don't turn us off too quick. We're going to have some homework tonight. But when you get a chance to read, chapters 10 through chapters 24 are filled with Solomon's wise sayings. You know, pretty much the whole book is, but chapters 10 through chapters 24, it deals with not where you get, you know, three or four or five verses primarily that deal on a specific subject matter. You will get to that when we get to chapter 30, where you'll hear from Gore and Limwell, certain things his mom said and all that. But in these chapters 10 through 24, you might get one or two verses, maybe three on a couple, that tie into a specific subject matter. These proverbs, most of them through chapters 10 through 24, are proverbs that have no specific order, but they cover a variety of different subjects. And can I say this? I believe that God has a word for every specific subject and every specific area in our lives. I believe that. I believe there is a word for whatever you go through. I might have to write a book about that. There is a word for whatever situation you find yourself in. God has a word for you and I there. So Solomon, when we're reading chapters 10 through 24, Solomon in his sayings, he's going to give us, it's interesting in our read. He's going to give like a positive side and a negative side. It may be a welcome and then on the flip side, a warning. It is, these proverbs are contrast to one another. It's a very clear difference from one side of the scripture to the other side of the scripture. It is antithetical. It is an opposite, if you will. So as we read, we're going to read these proverbs, and these proverbs are written, listen, to help us in our everyday life. These proverbs will help you live a life of that's pleasing to God, give us wisdom for every area of our life. Now, I don't know about you, but I need a word that's going to help me live every single day. Amen. For whatever circumstance, whatever situation I'm facing, it is great to have a word of God to go along with it. All right, are y'all still with me? So come with me to chapter 10. Chapter 10, we'll look and we'll go through we're going to get to a specific subject matter that I found in this chapter. But just let's look a little bit how this chapter starts off. Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 1. Here goes a reading of God's word. It says, "The Proverbs of Solomon. A wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish son is the grief of his mother." Can you say amen? Look, notice the contrast is between a wise doing wise things makes a father glad, and foolish things brings on grief to a mother. Notice the father will be happy if the son makes wise decisions, but the mother will be grieved if the son makes bad decision. I thought about that, and when we think about our lives and when we think about mothers and looking at what many of these theologians thought about when it comes to this, many times mothers are hurt more by a child's foolish behavior. Many of you mothers out there, you can testify, you can say amen, because when your child, your son or your daughter, when they make foolish behaviors, when do foolish things and things that bring about grief, it can many times hurt a mother more. Many times because that mother has of course birthed that child or cared for that child and raised that child. Mother has taught the child to do what is right and wrong, and mother made sure that the child knew the difference. Mothers many times, because they have such a close bond with their children, if that child behaves foolish, that child does something that breaks that mother's heart, it tends to be grievous to them. Solomon says, on the flip side, that if you do something, listen, that is wise, you make a father proud, a father glad, a father will stick out his chest, a father will do those things. It's a great contrast. The key that he's saying to us is we want to, as sons and daughters of many of our mothers and fathers have taught us things, we want to make sure that we act wisely. That we would do things that would bring our parents, make them smile. We would want to make our Heavenly Father We would want to make God proud in how we are behaving. I don't know about you, but that was one of the things I always wanted to make sure. I did the best I could to make sure that my mom and my dad were proud of my accomplishments and the behaviors. I wasn't trying to get in trouble. And Lord knows the things that we did do, we didn't want them to know about it. I know y'all didn't have to deal with that, but that's just me. Okay, so cool. Let's go back to it. Now, one of the things when we look through these chapters, chapter 10 through 24, and you're going to get your homework in a few minutes, but one of the things that I found in reading this chapter is how sometimes there may be a word, there may be some words that stick out in a specific chapter, or even as you go through several chapters that Solomon is addressing, or maybe he is theming something behind it. Maybe he wants to highlight certain things. Tonight we're going to find that in this chapter, there is this word called righteousness that Solomon identifies for us. Righteousness. When we think about righteousness is in the human behavior, in human definition, it is the quality of being morally true, or it is the quality of being justifiable. You're acting out morally. You're being justifiable in your actions. A deeper spiritual meaning of righteousness is it is the quality of being right in the eyes of God. Stop right there. In our human world, we want to be righteous, and that means we want to do and we want to act. We want to be morally correct. We want to be justifiable in our behaviors. But in the eyes of God, it is. The quality of being right in the eyes of God, and not just in what we do, but in what we say and how we think and what our motives are. All of that ties into righteousness. And righteousness, listen, really is just two parts. It is what you do, and many times righteousness is found in what you say. We're going to work on that a little bit. With God, we want to please God. So we want to make sure that we're righteous in His eyes. We're righteous in our character, which is our nature. We're righteous in our conscience, which is how we think or our attitude. We're righteous in our conduct and how we behave. We're righteous in obeying His commands, which is His word. Did you get that? So we got the command, which is the word of God. We're obedient and we're righteous. We've got our conduct and how we act. We've got our consciousness and how we think. And then we have our character and our nature and our makeup and how we live our lives. Righteousness is based on the standard and definition that God has given to us. God wants you and I to live righteous lives. Somebody should put that in the chat. God wants us to live righteous lives. So because of that, Solomon, the wisest man to ever live, it's like the Holy Spirit is breathing upon him as he is writing these Proverbs. And I want you to just go with me through chapter number 10. And there's some scriptures you may want to highlight or underline or put a circle around. And just let's identify and see what God is saying about being righteous. Are you with me? Come on, let's go through the scriptures. Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 3. Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 3. Look at what the word says. The Lord will not allow the righteous soul to famish, but He cast away the desire of the wicked. Can you say amen? So listen here. God will not allow the righteous soul to famish, but listen here. Those who are acting wicked, listen, those who are doing wickedly, He says that they will be cast away. Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 6. Notice this. Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 6. He's still talking about the righteous. Here's what He says. Blessings are on the head of the righteous. That's good news right there. but violence covers the mouth of the wicked. Can you say amen? Look at here, child of God. The blessings are on the head of the righteous, in our thoughts, how we think, how we behave, what comes out of our mouth. Listen, because those blessings are on the righteous, it will help us in what we say. I told you many times, people will see the righteousness on us, listen, mainly by how we live. But listen, many times it's not just how we live, but it is in what we say. Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 7. Look at what Solomon says, because we're under this theme of righteousness. He says, the memory of the righteous is blessed, but the name of the wicked will rot. When you and I think about men and women of God, maybe your mother, father, grandparents, aunties, uncles, somebody in church who listened, stood, and they lived righteous lives before God, and we look at them and we think about them, we have, man, wonderful thoughts, great memories because of how they lived their lives. On the flip side, there are some names that you might think about. Don't type those names in there. But there may be some folk that maybe they didn't live a righteous life before us. And the Bible says the name of the wicked will rot. Sometimes those names will be forgotten. Those people will be forgotten. The memory of them has not been a good thing. And those memories will rot away. Are you still with me? Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 11. Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 11. The mouth of the righteous is a well of life, but violence covers the mouth of the wicked. Can you say amen? Notice this now. He's dealing with the mouth. The mouth of the righteous is a well of life, but violence covers the mouth of the wicked. Can I tell you something? Righteous people, righteous men and women of God, listen, we must watch what comes out of our mouth. Let that one marinate. Take a little deep breath. Let me say it one more time. As a righteous son and daughter of God, you must be careful what words you let come out of your mouth. If your words, listen here, are words that are always cutting, that are belittling, if your words are hurting people, if your words are not encouraging and they're not uplifting, if they're not words of faith, if they're not words of wisdom, listen, ma'am, listen, sir, you may need to go and check your righteous status. If your words are always cutting and they're not uplifting, they're not words that the Lord is speaking, if your words are negative all the time and all that, you might need to check your righteous status, because your mouth should bring about words that are a well of life. It's like a picture of a fountain that springs forth words of wisdom, words of encouragement, words of life, words of hope. Can I tell you, people know when they're doing wrong, and you don't need to go and belittle them all the time and tell them how wrong they are and how bad they are. And they know that many times. But listen, to change their behavior, many times they may simply need a positive word. They may need a word of hope, a word of help. They may need a word from God, a scripture that's going to help them come out of where they are. And as sons and daughters of God, you and I've got to understand that the Bible says the mouth of the righteous is a well of life. So if you are claimed to be and profess to be a man and woman of God, please watch what you say. Amen to that. We're going to get deeper because it's going to have some more stuff. Solomon is going to get to us, and I'm almost where I need to be. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 16. We're still talking about this theme of righteousness. Listen what he says. Proverbs 10 and 16. The labor of the righteous leads to life, the wages of the wicked to sin. The labor of the righteous, your work, your efforts. Can I tell you, God is not unjust that he will forget your labor He's not going to forget your labor of love that you have shown to the saints. He is not going to forget your labor and the things that you have done to bring glory to his name. He is not going to forget that, because your labor as a righteous man or woman of God leads to life. And that life is not just life here on the earth, but it is a life that leads to eternal life. Can you say amen to that? But the wages of the wicked, the wicked's paycheck, if you will, is a paycheck of sin. And sin, if they don't know Jesus, have not come to repent of their sins, ask Jesus to come in their hearts, the wages, the Bible says, of sin is death. So we've got to be careful to make sure that and understand, as righteous sons and daughters of God, we are laboring for life. Are you still there? Proverbs chapter 10, verse 20. We see this theme that Solomon is writing. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 20, he says, "The tongue of the righteous is choice silver. The heart of the wicked is worth little." Can you say amen to that? Child of God, once again, the tongue of the heart. When we see this, the tongue of the righteous, rather, and we see the word the heart, they are kind of used in this passage, a parallel to one another. It is the tongue of the righteous. It is like something of great value, choice silver. It is something that is worth something. So your words, what you say, it means something. But then on the flip side, the heart, and the heart of the wicked leads to little. Now, many times, y'all remember a few weeks ago, we talked about how, listen, it is important for us to understand of how our tongue and our hearts kind of work together. The Bible says, out of the heart flows the issues of life. The flow, you're going to say what's in your heart. So you and I've got to understand that we should have, listen, we should have choice silver. We should have valuable words. We as righteous sons and daughters should speak words that are of great value to people. Amen. Let me keep on going. Let me help you. Look at what Solomon says. Solomon says in chapter 10, verse number 21, "The lips of the righteous feed many, but fools die for lack of wisdom." Can you say amen? Child of God, I don't know about you, but listen, I want to feed many with the words of God. I want to feed many with positive affirmations through God's word. I want to feed many with giving them hope, giving them help, giving them love through the word of God and by our actions. And the Bible says the lips of the righteous will feed many. How many in your family? How many people in your neighborhood? How many people on your jobs are hungry for you to give them a righteous word? They're hungry. And listen, if you and I don't feed them righteous word, listen, the Bible says that the fools will die for lack of wisdom. We're gaining all of this wisdom in the word of God. You and I have got to not just eat ourselves, but we've got to eat so that we can feed. Did you get that? We're learning. We're getting the word of God, and we're eating the whole roll, but you and I can't eat it all just for ourselves. We've got to eat, but we also have to feed others. Amen. That's so important. Keep on going. Proverbs as righteous. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 28 and 29. Watch this. Proverbs chapter 10, verses 28 and 29. Here's what it says. The hope of the righteous will be gladness, but the expectation of the wicked will perish. The hope of the righteous will be gladness, but the expectation of the wicked will perish. Verse 29, the way of the Lord is strength for the upright. That's another word for righteous. But destruction will come to the workers of iniquity. Can you say amen? Stop right there for a moment. The hope of the righteous will be gladness. You and I have hope. Listen here, we quoted, what is that? Hebrews 11 and 1. That, oh my Lord, I done went blank. Hebrews chapter 11, where now faith, here it is the substance of things, here it is, hope for, the evidence of things not seen. You and I have faith, and we're having faith and hope for something that we have not even seen. Child of God, the hope of the righteous will be glad. Those things are going to bring about such joy and gladness. The hope that we have, the expectation that we have, we have it because of our faith in Jesus Christ. But those that do not have that, their expectation of the wicked will perish. Those that don't have hope in Christ Jesus. And then it's going to lead to the way. The way of the Lord is strength. Because you and I are followers of Jesus Christ, that way is going to give us strength, because we are the righteous or the upright. But there is going to be destruction that comes to the workers of iniquity. Child of God, the path that the Lord has designed for you and I to go down, it's going to give you strength. God's way is the best way. Say it again. God's way, God's path is the best path. We quote all the time, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. God will direct your path. He will direct your way. You and I have got to understand that God's way will give us strength. As you and I walk along the way of God, it's a narrow path. It's a straight path. As we walk along this path, can I tell you, I found that God has strengthened me along this path. I know he's strengthened many of you along life's journey. Listen, God will strengthen you. He will lift you. He raises our heads. He dries our tears. He's mended our broken hearts. Come on, y'all don't play with me. You know God has done these things for you and I. But those who choose not to go down the path of the Lord, those who choose to work iniquity, there is another way that they will go. And that way leads to destruction. That way leads to perishing. But I'm so glad that our way leads to life. And we want to get many of them, as many as we can, off of that road of destruction and bring them onto the path or the highway of life. Can you say amen to that? All right, listen, let me get ready to wrap it up. I got you. You see the theme that Solomon is talking about. He's really speaking quite a bit on righteousness. Let's go down to chapter 10, verses 30, 31, and 32. Look at what it says. The righteous will never be removed, but the wicked will not inhabit the earth. The mouth of the righteous brings forth wisdom, but the perverse tongue will be cut off. The lips of the righteous know what is acceptable, but the mouth of the wicked, is perverse. Mouth of the wicked is perverse. Stop right there for a moment. Child of God, look at here. Do you see this running theme, this theme that he's talking about? The righteous will never be removed, but the wicked, they're going to be cut off. The theme of the righteous in their mouth is going to bring forth wisdom. Lips of the righteous know what is acceptable, but the perverse tongue will be cut off. The mouth of the wicked, it won't be preserved. Child of God, it is so important for us to understand that, listen, in righteousness is seen by how we live in our actions. But righteousness is also heard in our words, in what we say. This is the summarization. I'm done with this lesson. God wants us to live righteous lives. As we are attaining wisdom, as we're asking God for wisdom, as we're growing in the Word of God, God wants us not to just be wise in our mind, but we've got to be wise in our behavior and in our actions, and wise in our words. Because people will know the righteousness of God. They're going to see in how we live, how we're acting. And when they see how we're living and how we're acting, they're also going to be listening to what we say. Are you cussing everybody out? Are you fussing at everybody? Are your words negative? Are you one way this time and another way another? People are watching. They're listening to what we say. Child of God, God wants his sons and daughters, those of you and I who profess Jesus as Lord, he wants us to live righteous lives. When you and I, when we live righteous lives individually, listen, we can live righteously as a nation. I'm going to help you with that. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 34. And this is where we'll land the plane. Proverbs 14:34 says it this way. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Can you say amen? This is it. The plane has landed. We're getting ready to get off the plane. But listen to this. Solomon in this chapter, it seems to be a little theme. He talks about a few other things. He might mention integrity here and there. He talks about a few other things. But if you look closely, you'll see this word righteousness, this word upright. You'll see the word the righteous. He's talking and these wise sayings, and he is challenging us. He is encouraging us as sons and daughters to become the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus. That's the only way we can become right. We cannot be righteous on our own strength, but it only happens because of Jesus Christ. There's going to be a number that pops up, and this number is going to tell you to text for prayer. If you've never given your life to Jesus and you know, listen, Pastor Chris, I have been on that wicked end of the spectrum. I have not been on the righteous. And truth be told, none of us are righteous. There's only one right one. But God gives us the ability to live a life before him so that we can live as righteous as we can here on this earth. And I'm so thankful that even when we sin, we can go to him and we can confess our sin. And we ask him to forgive us, and he will do just that. And then he picks us up so that we can continue down this journey to walk as upright as we can in the word of God. But it starts with you having a relationship with Jesus. He loves you so much, he died for your sins and mine. If you'll text that number, we have men and women who want to pray with you and pray for you. Maybe you say, Pastor, listen, I struggle with this for whatever, and I need prayer in other areas. You text that number as well. We have men and women of God who want to pray with you and pray for you. I want to pray, and then I'm going to give you your homework assignment. So don't go anywhere. Stay in with the prayer. Father, I thank you for this time of sharing your word with your people. I know your word will not return unto you void. I thank you for this time as we, God, search the scriptures that we see. God, many times you're speaking to us, and it may be on a specific subject or whatever it is. I pray that you will help us to identify and hear what it is you are saying to us, God, so that we could live lives that are pleasing to you. Help us to walk upright before you, Father God. Help us, Father, if we stumble, that we will confess our sins and get back up and continue down the journey of trying to be right before you. I thank you, God. I thank you, dear Lord, that you're helping and strengthening us in our behaviors and in our actions. God, so that our behaviors and actions line up with your word. God, and not only in what we do, but Father, help us in what we say. Forgive us when we've spoken words, God, that have been negative and cutting and belittling. Forgive us, God, when our righteous words were not so righteous. Help us, dear Father, that we could speak words of life, and that our words will be a well of life to others. So I just thank you. Now, God, I pray, God, for your sons and daughters, my brothers and sisters. I pray your healing virtue. I pray your comforting grace be with them. I pray that you will continue to meet the needs in their lives. Bless them to be a blessing. Father, and I give you thanks and praise for this and so much more. And we do this in Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank God, and amen and amen. All right. Listen, before you put that pen away, before you put that paper away, I need you to know what your homework assignment is. Your homework assignment is, as we go through these next few days and things like that, I want you, as God leads you, to read some of these Proverbs, between specifically chapters 10 through 24, 25. Read these chapters, and as you're reading, identify if God is speaking to you about certain things. There may not be a theme like we see of righteousness in there, but God may be speaking to you about something throughout these different chapters. Maybe read a chapter a day. Maybe you go back, to whatever the day of the month it is. You know, the seventh. So you write down the seventh, read the seventh chapter, whatever it is. I want you to see what God is saying to you. Remember, we teach from this. What does the word of God say? Then what does the word of God mean? And thirdly, what is God saying to me? What is God saying to you individually through his word? What is the Spirit of God speaking to you to help you become a better son and daughter of God? Amen. All right, so listen, that is my time on tonight. I want to thank God for each of you tuning in. I pray that you were blessed, encouraged, challenged. Hope you see scripture a little differently tonight. And that as you read and as you study the word of God, that I know the Holy Spirit will begin to speak to you and help you as you and I continue in wisdom in the word. Now listen, our announcement, Clerk is coming in a few minutes, but I want to just say thank you in advance to those of you who will be coming on this Sunday to celebrate our third anniversary. We're so grateful to God. God has blessed me to pastor some of the most amazing people in the entire world. And I say that without reservation. I mean that from the bottom of my heart. And God has really blessed us. I love Second Baptist Church. And listen, Second Baptist, our wings have begun to spread. God has blessed us with people who tune in from all over. Matter of fact, if you're out of the state, you tell us where you are. I have family and friends who tune in every week from Kansas to Illinois to Texas to Connecticut. We're all over, and we love each and every one of you. We're so thankful. So thank you for those who are celebrating with us on this week. We love you with the love of God. Remember, this month on the 24th, we're going to have paper shredding right here on the campus. But then our very own lady, Renee Willis, is going to be leading us in a financial literacy class. So it's going to be a powerful time. We look forward to seeing you here. So thank you in advance. All right. Now that's my time. Our announcing clerk is going to come and lead us in our time of giving. We thank you in advance for your liberality. But I need you to know this. I love you with the love of the Lord, and there ain't a thing you could do about it. And if the Lord should tarry his coming and the creek don't rise, I look forward to seeing each and every one of you on this coming Sunday at 9 a.m. for Sunday school and 10 a.m. where we will be lifting up the name of Jesus. Stay safe, stay well. Let's continue to pray for one another. And I know God is going to do amazing things in your life. Have a good evening. God bless.
Second Baptist Children's Church Ministry presents Noah's Club. If your child between the ages of 8 and 16 is interested, email drjpharris@gmail.com and include the name of your child, age, grade level, and your contact number. Children of every age group can worship and learn together. Here are the meeting times and dates. SBC's Pantry Ministry meets every Tuesday from noon to 1 p.m. Men and women ought to always pray and not lose heart. If you want a prayer warrior to pray with you, text the word prayer to 626-495-3020. We will pray with you and for you. On every first Wednesday of the month, connect with our Zoom Prayer Hour. Join Pastor Chris every Wednesday at 7 p.m. for Wednesday in the Word. On Mondays at 6:30 p.m., participate in a Monday Mindset meeting with the Brotherhood Layman's League or the United Women's Fellowship Guild.
Come check out Bibles, books, gifts, and more at the SBC Bookstore. We're open the third Saturday of every month from 11 to 2 and after Sunday services. Hope to see you soon.
Can you believe that YouTube is a potential mission field? It can be with your help. Each time you click the thumbs up button on a Wednesday in the Word or Sunday worship service video, it tells YouTube that our content is interesting to viewers and expands our reach. People come to YouTube and other social media platforms to escape today and, more importantly, search for answers. Help the Second Baptist Church channel appear in more feeds to reach more people. The more people we reach with the gospel message, the more people we can point to the way, the truth, and the life. Click the button on every past, present, and future Wednesday in the Word and Sunday service. For Wednesday in the Word, comment as well as use the live chat. Become a YouTube missionary today. If your ministry has announcements, send them to 2bcmonrovia@gmail.com. The announcements must be received by Monday at 5 p.m. to air during Wednesday and Sunday services. Anointed Rhythms of Praise is seeking all individuals to be a part of their Media Day fall performance this October. They are having an informational meeting this Thursday at 7 p.m. via Zoom. Text the word DANCE to 626-495-3020 to get more information regarding this unique opportunity. Mark your calendars for Pastor Chris's anniversary celebration, which is on Sunday, September 11th at the 10 a.m. morning worship service. If you want to give a monetary gift to Pastor Chris through the mobile app, select Pastor's Appreciation to direct those funds to the anniversary. The Diakonos are continually and fervently praying for you. Yes, the new and seasoned members of SBC. They want to remind you that if you desire to have additional prayer or have a specific prayer request, they are available to pray with you and for you. The Gazette has the list of Diakonos names who are designated for praying directly with you, according to the first letter of your last name. You can call the office for their phone numbers. Do you have the skills needed to serve in our media ministry? If so, join our team. Contact us at 2bcmonrovia@gmail.com. Thank you for watching our weekly announcements. Be blessed.